News from Japan. More secondary tremors and nearly 7,500 dead. Reactors 3 and 4 down, 5 and 6 are in danger. A radioactive cloud hangs over the Fukushima plant. Fukushima, area restricted. What is it like after the disaster that took place only a few years ago? I decided to see it with my own eyes. The aftermath is hardly ever discussed, and the events of March 2011 are becoming history. Is the situation in the prefecture under control and back to normal? During my journey, I reminisced about Chernobyl. The two events are different because of their scale, causes, and reaction of the authorities. But I know what impact radioactive contamination can have. I headed straight to the Fukushima Prefecture, nearly 250 kilometers away from Tokyo. More precisely, to a town near Power Plant 1. Tomioka was seriously affected by the earthquake, tsunami, and the power plant disaster. In many places, life returns to normal. Stores, gas stations, and restaurants have reopened. And there's a school with only 18 children for now, but the situation may soon change. Authorities are making every effort to enable residents to return. New residents are to arrive as well, lured by attractive job offers. Granted that they will not fear living near the power plant. But many places still remind us of what happened in 2011. Tomioka is one of 13 towns within the 30-kilometer disaster evacuation zone. The plant is just 8 kilometers away, but contamination wasn't the authorities' biggest problem. Most of the radioactive cloud moved northwest, barely catching the borders of Tomioka. But the town suffered from the earthquake and the tsunami, which was tallest here, reaching over 18 meters. At first glance, the situation looks normal now, but a look at the numbers shows that normalcy hasn't come back yet. Tomioka was partially reopened a few months ago. It now has 5 times fewer residents than before 2011, mainly visiting workers dealing with the aftermath of the disaster. Some parts of Tomioka are still inaccessible.
Por
Not all locations within the area affected by the disaster are open. Many places still require passes, reluctantly issued by local authorities. If you think that you can just come here and see everything, you are wrong. The closed-off sections are guarded, and the Japanese are very strict about any infractions. Visits to any red zone, even with authorization, are constantly supervised. Entries and exits are registered, and all access roads are closely guarded. Some 15% of Tomioka is in the red zone. There are 5 red zones. Residing here is forbidden, and entry requires a special pass. 500 workers handle the decontamination. This will continue for another year, and normal life will resume in 2023, 12 years after the disaster. An unusual sight awaits in the red zone. Everything looks as if the disaster happened just a few months earlier. The phrase, "time stands still," comes to mind, as if people hadn't been evacuated, but simply disappeared. Right after the central alarm system notified the residents of the event, they had to rush to rally points, set up mostly in public utility buildings like this one. This is a sports and recreation center. 3 kilometers away from the plant was not enough. The residents had to be moved further. Everything they had with them remains here to this day. This place is safe now. You just need shoe protectors because there are rodent feces all around. In total, nearly 160,000 people were evacuated from a 30-kilometer perimeter around Power Plant 1. A big number. Terrifying considering the fact that just a few have returned home. Around the prefecture, especially in locations most affected, there are many deserted buildings, unwanted relics, witnesses of events everyone would rather forget. March 11th, 2011. This day marked a new, tragic chapter in the history of Japan. At 2:46 p.m., an earthquake occurred on the East Coast. The strongest one in 140 years. It was followed by a huge tsunami reaching over 10 kilometers inland. The disaster destroyed ports and towns and claimed nearly 20,000 lives. Some buildings are still standing, and their interiors still contain clear mementos of normal times. There are many such places here. Terrible smell. I need a mask. The smell doesn't come from rotten goods, but from rats. This has been bitten through. Rats had a great time here. It really stinks. The rats ate what they could, but many products, electronics, and the like, canned goods, are all untouched. They are inedible. But when I listen closely, I know the rats are close. I hear them squeak. I'm not sure it's safe here. Exploring Fukushima's buildings is a unique experience, but I need more answers to paint a full picture of the disaster. And more history. Futaba is one of five red zones. The bigger part of the plant is here. It's unique because the zone covers the entire town. There isn't a soul here, apart from crews conducting decontamination work. Former residents sometimes appear, mainly to visit their birthplace. I have the unique opportunity to meet such a person. Mr. Shino invited me to his home and car workshop, which he ran before the disaster. You lived and worked here. How did the disaster affect your life? Before the explosion, we ran a family workshop here with my wife and children. On March 11th, right after the disaster, I was forced to evacuate. Since then, they keep moving me around. I have moved 6 times now. Are you here often? How do you feel when you see all this? Would you like to return? I don't come here at all. I came today as an exception. There is radioactive waste everywhere. Even if we joined forces to clean it all up, it would probably take decades. We'd die before the work was done. That's why we will never return here. It's hard to imagine how a man forced to abandon his life feels. Mr. Shino's past remains forever locked inside the walls of his home, which he had invited me to. Untouched for years, it got stuck. This is tangible proof of the earthquake. Success! Though, like he said, everything became crooked in 2011. Let's take a look inside. No need to take off your shoes. You had a beautiful home. It brings a tear to my eye, so I can only imagine what you feel. Do you remember how the earth shook back then in March 2011? After the earthquake on March 11th, water started leaking in through the roof. It was a huge leak. I thought I would return, so I put a blue tarp over the roof as protection from the rain. I got a camera and took pictures of the places the tsunami went over. When I returned home, I was told we had to evacuate. We didn't know what to expect, but because the days were still cold, we took blankets and mattresses with us. We got into the car as we stood and drove off to Fukushima. Me, my wife, and my parents. Once the decontamination is complete, would you want your descendants to return to this house, to live where you lived for so many years? My descendants will not return here. What awaits this place? They've been working on it and will continue. But even if it becomes okay to return, there is no work here. Thank you for showing me your home and sharing these sad memories. Goodbye. Thank you. The story I heard here is not the story of just one family. Tens of thousands had to leave everything behind, abandon their past, without the option to return. I'm approaching the most important point of my visit, the Fukushima Daiichi power plant, the epicenter of the disaster. In a dozen or so minutes, we will find out what it looks like. Power Plant 1 is now one of the most guarded places in Japan. Decontamination work is underway, and the plant is partially active. Obtaining a permit to enter and film was a successful, but difficult task. The visit itself was subject to tight restrictions. First, I had to pass several inspections. Health and safety training took an hour and a half. Next, it was time for examinations. This magic chair shows how many units of radiation are on you, or rather, in you. My 840 is the best result in the crew. By the time we leave, it can't increase by 1500. No idea what would happen if it did. I hope it doesn't. After the preparations, one last stage remained. 2 hours after entering the plant, I could finally board the bus which was to take me around the facility. The entire complex occupies over 350,000 square meters. The damaged reactors stand on the waterline, about 800 meters from the offices. Moving about on foot would take much more time than I was allowed. For safety reasons, our visit was limited to the necessary minimum. Moving about the area freely was out of the question. As formalities go, it was nothing like Chernobyl.
The
We are approaching a point from which we can see reactors 1 to 4. We may step out of the bus. I hope we can get close. About 50 meters behind us is the ocean. This is a crucial spot. Let's go. Radiation levels are very high here. In some places, my meter shows over 90 microsieverts. Where the workers are, it's even higher. They can spend 500 hours per year there. When I extend my hand, it's already over 90. We can't stay here for long. The meters ping from time to time, telling us that we should leave. Several hundred meters away from the reactors, radiation levels are nearly 200 times higher than in cities. However, a short visit shouldn't leave any side effects. In March 2011, the situation was very different. The earthquake destroyed the power lines, and the facility had to switch to diesel generators. They operated for an hour. The incoming tsunami wave was over 10 meters high. It crashed over the safety wall, flooding the generator rooms below and switching them off. Water made it impossible to use the next power source, batteries, whose connections were flooded. Still, operators could use the steam inside the reactor to launch an emergency cooling pump. But there was an undetected leak in the system. The water level in reactor core 1 began to drop rapidly, causing temperature and pressure to rise, culminating in an explosion. This place is exceptionally unsafe. I can spend just 5 minutes here. I am walking on thick metal plates. Here we can see the results of the quake and the tsunami. Blocks 1, 3, and 4 exploded. Block 2 was damaged because of what happened in block 1. A very interesting, but also dangerous place. Hydrogen explosions and fires, which started on March 12th in Reactor 1, lasted for 4 days. In the meantime, emergency services and plant workers risked their lives to prevent an even bigger disaster by cooling the reactors with seawater while trying to restore control over the system. Radiation didn't help. It was much lower than in the Chernobyl explosion, but still hazardous. The highest values registered in the area exceeded 1 sievert per hour, which is a lethal dose. Reactors 1, 2, and 3 suffered core meltdowns. But the biggest threat was the block of reactor 4, which during the quake was offline for inspection. Reactor 4 also suffered in the tsunami. Inside, there were 1,500 fuel rods. The entire upper section here is new. If another quake were to happen, these 1,500 rods inside might have fallen down, probably causing a much bigger disaster. During the inspection, all fuel rods of Reactor 4 were in a water tank on the upper level of the reactor. The quake damaged the building, but the pillars supporting the tank survived the disaster. More problems appeared on March 15th, when, for reasons still unknown, there was an explosion near the rod tank, probably caused by collecting hydrogen. Luckily, the explosion didn't damage any rods. The disaster that would have followed the collapse of Reactor 4 did not happen. But the fuel rods were still a major threat. The removal of 4-meter containers with radioactive uranium was very risky. The smallest damage to the rods could have caused contamination. Work on Reactor 4 commenced in 2013 and was concluded a year later. Work is underway to shut off the reactors and remove nuclear fuel from the remaining units. The condition of the buildings raises the challenge. It's not the only problem the engineers face. Years ago, the Japanese invented unique tunnel drilling technology. Probably nobody expected it to be used in a nuclear plant disaster. The pipes below me contain liquid nitrogen. The pipes, stretching 1,500 meters, encircle all 4 blocks of the plant. This structure is about 30 meters deep and creates an ice barrier. It was built in 2015 to prevent one of the worst consequences of the disaster, groundwater contamination. Before the barrier was placed, groundwater flooded the area with melted, highly radioactive fuel, causing the immediate spread of contamination. Freezing the ground 30 meters deep greatly reduced the volume of flowing water, from 400 to 280 tons per day. The stopped water is pumped out to the surface, and radioactive liquid is directed to tanks, which contain water used to cool reactors. Hazard zones require protective clothing, such as this: hard hat, glasses, a vest with special pockets where you place ice water. I am now by the contaminated water tanks. There are 950 of them. Each contains 1,300 cubic meters. The most harmful substance found in that water is triton, though trace amounts of other harmful elements are there as well. These tanks here are completely new, built with the most advanced technology. Those ones were assembled from prefabricated parts and often leaked water. These are safe and good for 30 to 40 years. I didn't ask what happens later. Each day, these tanks receive 150 cubic meters of contaminated water. It is easy to calculate that filling one tank takes less than 10 days. That is why most of the area here is filled with tanks, and more keep appearing. What will they do when they run out of space? Despite the tight supervision, I decided to ask the plant employees. Could you describe the plant's decontamination process? What challenges and problems do you face? The plant shutdown operation involves several tasks, but generally speaking, the first issue is contaminated water. Secondly, nuclear material containing radioactive fuel. And thirdly, the waste. We'd like to urgently solve the problem of what to do with the partially decontaminated water. We are waiting for the government's decision on this matter. We are thinking of some final utilization method. On the task we consider most difficult, which is the removal of leftover fuel, we are conducting pre-implementation research. Since this could pose a threat in the future, we must consider this from the point of strict storage management. With the waste, each year we predict how much waste will be created in the 10-year shutdown process. We conduct simulations and build new buildings to store the waste here in the vicinity of the plant. What happens with the fuel rods? This is the most dangerous element involving radiation in a nuclear plant. The normal procedure is clear, but what do you do in a disaster? Currently, at the power plant, we have melted fuel in reactors 1, 2, and 3. Our aim, once we have removed the fuel, is to place it in canisters, which are barrels, metal containers, for storage in a stable and controlled manner. What can be considered a hazard involving nuclear material is lack of controlled storage. Purely hypothetically, and I hope it doesn't happen, but what if tomorrow there was another disaster, an earthquake of the same magnitude followed by a tsunami? Have you secured the area of the plant to prevent a similar disaster? Can a similar disaster occur? The plant is not operating, so the same thing won't happen. That's impossible. But we do still have nuclear material in the form of leftover fuel, and there is a certain risk. If a tsunami flooded the area with the fuel and then receded, it would carry everything into the sea. But we have preventive measures. We've built a wall to protect against high water, and entrances into buildings have been sealed to prevent water from entering. The events of 2011 were a series of incredible coincidences. An earthquake not seen in 140 years. A very high tsunami wave. But do you think that you did everything at the time, before the disaster, to prevent it from happening? We are aware that we were insufficiently prepared for the tsunami. From today's perspective, we see that the safeguards were insufficient. The interview resembled the rest of the visit. The cautious answers came as no surprise. This is a company whose name is associated with the biggest nuclear disaster since 1986. Having toured the plant for a few hours, I returned to the same room to check the dose of radiation I received. I have to wait for the machine. We'll see. Fortunately, the numbers are legible, because the rest is not. I was at 841 upon entry. Now, I am at 1076. That's more, but the difference is small. I'll be okay. Thank you. I left the power plant with mixed feelings. I saw how much work and effort is put into removing the aftermath, not to mention the money. And the sums are going into billions. The ice barrier costs nearly $1 billion, and its annual operation requires as much energy as 13,000 households. The process will take at least 30 years more, so the final cost is hard to predict. But I was under the impression that this tragedy brought on consequences that nobody can deal with. What should be done with the contaminated water? The fuel removal method is still being researched, and no one can say when the highly radioactive fuel will be isolated from the environment. But the ongoing tasks are being done with dedication, also those outside the power plant. When the city and suburbs are contaminated, there's the problem of contaminated soil. The Japanese decided to remove a 5 to 10 centimeter layer of soil from all of the zones. That soil is in these sacks here. Each sack is a ton. So 120 million sacks give 120 million tons of soil. Their number continues to grow. Ultimately, all sacks will be moved to a central stockpile. They will remain there for 30 years. What happens later, nobody knows. There are soil stockpiles all over the contaminated zone. Every day, around 10,000 people work on removing the aftermath. Decontamination is bringing visible results. Zones are reopened and residents can return to their homes. Radioactive dust, which had settled on an area of nearly 600 square kilometers, has been removed from 90% of the area. The remaining area are the mentioned red zones. The Fukushima project is the biggest decontamination project in history, estimated at over $200 billion. Money is not the only problem. The radioactive clouds spread to an area with tens of thousands of inhabitants. The first question is, what about the health of those exposed to radiation? Nearly 10 years have passed, but many issues haven't been clarified yet. Local and international agencies claim that radiation levels were too low to cause any health issues. Private institutions point to their own research, which shows a drastic increase of thyroid cancer incidence in children. Just as in the case of Chernobyl, the truth will defend itself. But that will take time. Meetings with residents, officials, and doctors awarded me a close look at the true image of the Fukushima disaster. This accident affected not just those who lived nearest to the plant. The aftermath extends far beyond the actual radiation zone, reaching people in highest positions. And I'm not just speaking metaphorically. The consequences of the tragedy could have been worse. An evacuation of Tokyo was considered. The city has over 10 million residents, and the agglomeration nearly 40, more than the population of Poland. Though the Fukushima plant is 240 kilometers away from Tokyo, the city reported a small increase in radiation after the disaster. When the effects of the accident weren't fully known, residents of the capital quickly became anxious. How does one evacuate such a city? Had it come to that, the unprecedented decision would have been made by the Prime Minister. When you learned about what happened in the plant, you didn't have all the data. There was a risk that the disaster could spread outside Japan to the world. Which of the hard decisions you had to make were the most difficult? In the course of work following the accident, the most difficult moment was the assessment and decision of March 15th. When the CEO of TEPCO asked to evacuate the entire crew from the power plant. If all the workers maintaining the plant were to abandon their posts, The six reactors of Fukushima Daiichi and four reactors of Fukushima Daiini, 10 kilometers away, would have melted down within weeks or months at the most. All 10 reactors. That would have released huge amounts of radioactive elements into the environment. If that had happened, Japan would have ceased to exist. The worst-case scenario called for the evacuation of the entire Tokyo agglomeration. How would it have proceeded? This seems unimaginable. Soon after the accident, I had this worst-case scenario in my mind, developed by specialists, calling for the evacuation of as many as 50 million people in a radius of 250 kilometers. I kept that in mind, though initially I didn't talk about it. If the PM had started talking about evacuation when we were not prepared for it, it would have caused panic. In the end, the evacuation of all of Tokyo wasn't necessary. Fortunately, the threat was smaller than anticipated. If things had been different, Japan would have been much worse off than having lost a 15-year war. Even now, when I think about it, it sends shivers down my spine. Seeing the aftermath, I had no doubts about the scale of destruction. The Prime Minister's words opened more doors. The weight of the events began to approach the level of one of the greatest disasters of the modern world. The scenario of expanding the evacuation zone to 250 kilometers could have brought a mighty country to its knees. The nation found itself on the precipice of doom. This fatal step was avoided, but we can't call it a happy end. There is nothing happy about abandoned homes, deserted cities and streets, resembling scenes from a post-apocalyptic film. Officials claim the situation is under control, but not everyone trusts these assurances. One day, residents will be able to return home. Some of them will, but some wish never to come back. No one knows what future awaits this region. One thing is certain: Fukushima will always be associated with a huge nuclear disaster.